So we are in session 32 today. We'll continue with HR project development. In this session, we will cover the application overview, map into the multi-layer design. We'll look into the all those elements that we have laid out in the first place. And implementing department module, the save scenario, will drill down into one by one and implement each of the modules step by step. We'll do a step-by-step process instead of running through the code. We'll do how we can implement all layers. And we'll also see an enterprise library 5.0 overview and what is it and how can we use it. And we'll see especially the data access application blocks, in short DAB. We will also see exception handling application blocks, how can we use it, and also logging application blocks, lab. And we'll see in ASP.NET user control, how can we create a user control and consume in other forms. And we'll see a custom control. I want to go with a good example of what is the difference between a user control and a custom control. And also we'll see a helper module implementation and walkthrough of how we can create a helper module and make use of it across all the other layers of the project. Okay, saying that, well, let's kick off session 32. So we know that we have been working on HR project, and today we'll see the demo again. And again, we'll walk through the same requirements spec and then walk through each one of them, and then let's see if anything is missing, and we'll track back on what is pending, and then we'll start coding. Instead of walking through the code, what I'm going to do today is start writing the code, and so that'll give you a much better picture of how to really code starting from the database to the middle tier components and the complete UI. So we're going to do that as a primary focus, and down the line, if we see some time, we will also walk through the enterprise library, how can we make use of it, how can we leverage it, and of course as part of the coding, we're going to make use of it extensively. So we're going to use for exception handling, database access, and logging. Okay. And here we have the employee managed screen, and we'll walk through our application. So this is the code that we have as of today. So so we have done the employee part. We're going to walk through one by one and see. So the authentication part is here. So the application is secure, so I need to log in to gain access. That's one part of the requirements fulfilled. And another one is the admin screen, and admin screen wherein we have a security matrix. And what I'm trying to do here is trying to make use or leverage the configuration tool that's available as part of the ASP.NET. So it's an ASP.NET website administration tool. I'm actually leveraging the whole thing to configure the security aspects as well. So we did walk through this tool, how to create users, manage the users, and also their roles and access, their access rights and everything else. So we can do the same tool and apply the changes to the database, and it's going to work seamlessly. And we already walked through how to use this tool, so needless to go through this. There's nothing too much there because we haven't done anything there. All we did is redirect. All I did is just to create the link to that tool and create it and redirect it to it. So how I did that again? Yes. So again, that's a very simple thing. I can walk through. Link is on the admin page, which is under my admin root and under the admin master page. So in the admin master page, I have the menu item which has a navigate URL, and I just hard-coded this navigate URL to map to the tool. And I got this URL, of course, by running from the application side, project and ASP.NET configuration. So it's going to pretty much open the same tool. And I just copied this tool and made that link possible there. But this is again just to again brief you that this is only for our demo sake, and also you can use that, there's no harm in using it. It will work good as long as you're making the use of the database. Security is part of the application itself. That means that security information is part of the database itself. But in the real world applications, it's not going to be that way. So in real world applications, the authentication is done making a call to the Active Directory. There will be middle tier components that you can leverage to gain. Do the Active Directory integration to do the authentication on the Windows-based systems. So that's going to be completely different. We're not going to touch that part. So within the scope of our application, we're able to successfully implement the login and authorization and authentication. Okay. The next thing is we have already walked through how we created these grids. Using the grid view, we are able to manage to create and edit editable grids and also manage to edit this part of the program. Again, I don't want to walk through the same thing again. That's not something new. And another thing is this part of the page is what we are more interested in because this is going to make use of our design. Where we follow the multi-layer approach, where we have the data access layer, the business workflow layer, and the domain object model, and all the things. And again, just a quick demo, just to make sure it's working fine as it has been. We're going to create a new record here. While creating a new record, a couple of things we want to check here is the client-side validation and the server-side validation happening. And in this case, all these validations right now are actually coming from the server-side validation. So I actually disabled the client-side validation for now. So we will walk through the details of validation again. So when the idea or the target for today is to do all of this same implementation starting from the UI to the database for the department page. I left it blank for the sake of a demo. And I already did the employee because this is a little big screen, so that's why I able to finished it earlier, so that we spend little time in our training and also cover all the topics that are necessary. So in this case, I'm just going to put some test last name. Quickly fill up this with some data and department 12, and I'll say test. At test.com and phone number 4567891234. Okay, some number and test street and city is test city and state I'll say NJ and zip something. Okay, I'm going to put the permanent address as well. P stands for permanent and P test street, city as a P city, state as a PA and some zip code. Okay, this should be a successful entry unless if there is any. Yeah, it is, and I'm able to successfully save it, and I'm going to edit that information. Now I'm going to put some valid name. A valid name, I would say some Shaha, and usually Shaha will be the last name and the first name say Chintan, some name. Okay, and also I'll try to change the gender here, and I will not touch that part, and I'll put some number here. Just want to make sure that as you know, these each of these blocks are actually going to have a different line items. The first block we see here, so this part up to this managed employee part, this whole part is actually going into the employee table, and this part is going into a different table, which is an address table, and this is also going into the address table as a different entry. So what's happening in this screen is a complex transaction process. We are actually doing one insert here to employee table, and this one is going into the address table as a one record, and this one is also going to the address table. Okay, so this is a little complex table we have. And what are the advantages of doing that, and why to make it so complex, right? So we'll see the advantages also down the line. So this record is saved successfully, and as we see, this is the address line item that's gone into the different table. Okay, there's two records, that 42 and 43 are the one, and for now we can actually go through our screen, our the grid view screen, and see the 42 and 43 is gone to the next page, because we already have a pagination as well added part of it. Okay, so this is a good place to even test the pagination, because now the data is pretty good enough. Good, so that works good. So we don't have to worry about that. Now what we need to do is, we will do the, all of that for department. Okay, so where we start with and how to start with, we're going to go step by step. Okay, now I'm going to kill this application. I presume the demo for the current application, the state of the application right now, whatever it is, it's running good. And the exception logging part, I can quickly demo it for now, but we will do the enterprise library as well. So how to configure the enterprise library to leverage all that we are doing today. And in this case, I'm deliberately going to break this page, and I see a file does not exist error, and I have actually configured the logging to go to one particular place, and that place is configured in the logging configuration, which is here. So this is where I configured it to log, and we will come back to this again down the line today if we have enough time to cover that. Otherwise, in the next session. So I see the logs have been created, and I can see the error getting logged in the flat file. Okay, and the error, the file, as we see, this is a file that was keyed in deliberately, so it found that it doesn't exist. So the exception got logged along with the stack trace and the bare minimal information that anyone needs. So this is how this is again a production ready code, I would say. So you can actually deploy this into production, and this is ready to use, and we can see the rolling of the file is happening automatically, and we'll come back on this, as I said. So what is the rolling means, and how can we do this, how much of code we need to write for that to happen. And in addition to logging to a flat file here, I'm also doing logging the same thing to a database. Okay, so that's the beauty of enterprise library. I can log the same information. Did I connect? I hope. So I'm going to, this is the logging database that can be created. And whenever I'm logging to a flat file, at the same time, I can also redirect that same information to log into the database. So inside the database, I can see the logging information here under the message, and view the same information, and we see that exception got logged in the database as well. So this is working perfectly, and no issues today. So we will walk through the configuration part of how we can make the enterprise library do all this for us with a bare minimal lines of code. Okay, and that's again a very important thing. Industry out there extensively use enterprise library because of all these advantages. With the cross-cutting concerns are taken care, and you don't have to write the code for handling the general constraints like logging or exception handling, caching, security, and things like that. So there are a wide variety of things are there. So okay. Now, so what we're going to do is, we're going to start our coding. Definitely, for going back to the coding, I would love to always go back to our presentation and walk through the design. So the first thing, because as a developer, as we discussed, that we will have these documents available, and you were assigned to implement the page, and the page need to follow this sequence diagram. So we have the sequence diagram talks about which are the components need to be touched to get the things done, and what are the tiers or layers available here. So in this case, just to recap on the sequence diagram, this is the user who's going to hit a UI with the click event. And upon the click event, what we're going to do is, in this case, this is for employee, but the same thing we're going to apply for the department also. And it's going to create an employee, or in our case, it's going to create an instance of a department object and populate it and pass it to the immediate tier called the BWC. Okay, so once BWC is done, BWC is going to make the call to the data access component in the data access layer. And the data access component is responsible to interact with the database components. So what we're going to do is, from either we go from top to down or bottom to up. Either way, we can actually start with. Ideally, in production environment scenarios, in a real-time project scenarios, you might see that different people are assigned to work on different components. You might see people who are completely experts in database. They might do only the database part. And whoever is experts in data access layer, they will do only this part, and vice versa, so on. So some are very good in the GUI design for rich graphics and other things. And in our case, we are not at all bothering about the how rich we can make your application. We are completely concentrating on the coding part of the other layers. And also, we are not giving much stress on the database as well. Of course, we will write the stored proc. We will write the stored proc and make the call through the data access layer. But what I mean to say is, we will not actually do a very extensive database programming. We will do a bare minimal, which is sufficient for our demo. Okay, so we will start now. So in my case, I prefer to start from the bottom up. Okay, so we're going to start with the database stored proc and then go all the way up. Okay, so the database part. So we know that we have our database embedded as part of our application, and this is our main database. And of course, we can see that from on our left-hand Server Explorer. And within this, we have these three tables that are created originally. And this is a table that we have been accessing so far, the employee table, the address table, and the department table. And of course, they have data. We can see them. So the data that we are seeing on the application side is coming from this database tables. Okay, so we are clear that this is the database that we are using. And from application side, how do you know that this has been accessed? We need to go back to the web.config to know that. Okay, within the web.config, there is a section called data configuration. Okay, so within the data configuration, we have the connections strings section. Within this, we have the main database as application, HR application DB connection. And of course, this name doesn't map to this, although, yeah, so anyway, in this case, the HR application DB connection is a name, and the database file is actually part of the catalog. Here we have the, since this is a file reference, it's directly added up here. In the other case, we also have the logging database, and this logging database is actually going to the SQL Server database, not embedded as part of our database model. So down the line, if you get the source code down, although I'm making use of this the SQL Server database, which is running on the SQL Server, not in the within the Visual Studio, is used for enterprise library logging, for the exception logging. Okay, this might not work if you don't have that. If you get the Express SQL Server Express edition, then it's perfectly good. You can actually run that. And as I said, the exception logging is the last thing that I'll go today. We'll start with the implementing the department side. Okay, so this part is clear. We know that the application is using this database. That's the first step to know. Where is the data source and how are we making use of it? At this point, we know that this connection is available in the connection strings, and this is the database that we are using. Good. One step done. And next thing is stored proc. So within that database, okay, this will be collapsed, and within this database, we have something called stored procs. And everyone, I presume, know what is a stored proc. I will not, that's what I said, we will not do a lot of database programming. I presume that you know all what is a table, you know what is a view, you know what is a std proc and all those fundamentals, okay? And in this case, the first thing I'm going to do is create a new std proc. Right click and add a new one, and by default I have a template. In this case I'll say create department. Good. And ideally speaking, you can also, there will be naming conventions definitely in the real-time world. They generally, what I have seen is people would like to prefix these std proc names with USP and the underscore and things like that. So, okay, we want to keep it simple. Okay, we don't want to worry about too much of naming conventions. And in this case, of course, the std proc, what it's going to do is it's going to insert, seen by the name itself, it's going to create the entry into the department table. So this is the department table that where I want to store this information down. So I will write my Seek database std proc to do exactly that. Okay. So the interesting thing with this model, outside you might see as different ways people do it, and the way I am, I designed this application and the way I am coding, I'm actually making a one-to-one mapping to each and everything. So in this case, when I say create department, although we know that the department also contains a location, which is address, I'm not actually tightly coupling it within the std proc. So that's the limitation I'm putting. So again, I'm trying to apply the separation of concerns principle everywhere, because that's eventually going to give you a lot of benefit. And what is that benefit, we'll see today. So with that approach, what I'm trying to do here is my create department will actually create a record only in the department table, although it does have a containment of an address. Okay, if we go back to our original design with the domain object model, this is a very key thing to I wanted to see the domain object model. Yes, this is the one. So within the domain object model, if you see the class diagram, although the department has a containment relationship to the address, that means the location is of type address, I'm not actually, when I say create department, I'm not creating the records in both the tables. And same thing I did with the employee as well. The reason being, in this case, if you see, it has two addresses, and the address is separated because of the data that it is going to have is common elements. And if I want to have multiple addresses within the employee, I don't want to repeat the same fields everywhere. I don't want to have like a permanent address line 1, permanent address line 2, and so on. So it's again a bad design practice. So wherever you can reuse, it's again goes back to your normalization of your database, and same normalization principle I'm applying with the domain object model as well. And the same thing will go back all the way back to your database design as well. Okay, so in this case, when I say create data department, I will create record inside the department, okay, only. And this will go very simple. It's going to have one insert statement. And IntelliSense doesn't really help here, so I have to really use my coding skills, otherwise it's going to break. Okay, it's normal that things might break in normal coding, and we'll definitely try to resolve them. That's quite common as part of development. So in this case, what I'm trying to do here is I'm going to get all the parameters that need to get into the department table. And in this case, if you know the ID is an auto-generated field. If I open the table definition, is that, yes, this is not a definition. Open the table definition. So if you see, this is a primary key and it's an identity column in the database itself. That means when you really save records to it, it's the identity specification is set to yes. And when you really try to insert data for identity column, you normally have to skip that because that's automatically generated by the database. So I'm going to skip the ID. I'm going to take name, and this is of type varchar of 50. I believe that's the length it has. That's fine. If it is greater than 50 also, eventually it's going to break anyway, but we need to we'll see how, if it breaks and how to handle the exception. Those are the things we need to really master. And HOD is a reference to something else, which is of type int. And the location, in this case, location is just an ID, if you remember, because that's having the referential integrity to the address table, and location is an int. Okay, so I know the design because that's how I able to see that it's just an ID that's referring to it. And if you really see the data, that's how it is going to be. So HOD is a referential integrity to employee ID, whereas the location is a referential integrity to address ID. So this department table is pretty simple, and keeping that simple will also make our stored products simple. So I'm going to insert into department table and say values. Of course, before I say department, I want to explicitly specify the column names also. It's already always a general good practice to specify the column names that where you're inserting and the values. In normally, if you don't specify, that's a normal database stored product or database SQL's information. If you don't specify the list of fields, then it assumes that you provide the values for all the fields. Okay. In this case, since I'm not going to pass information for ID, I have to specify the respective fields for which I'm going to pass the information. Okay, makes sense, right? If anything doesn't make sense to you, you can drop a line. We can talk about that. Okay, HOD. And again, why I'm putting it within the square brackets, that's again not mandatory, but it's general good practice to keep it. Ideally, if you have a column names with a space within it, then you need to enclose within these square brackets, otherwise you don't have to. In this case, really I don't have to, but I'm just following the general good practice. And location. So these are the columns, and the values are here. The values are my parameters, as good as name. And SQL Server, it's one thing you might notice that this @ symbol follows the name is a parameter. If you are doing with Oracle, then you don't see this @ symbol. It's going to be pretty much like a straightforward variable names. But for SQL Server, it is this syntactically it is followed by the @ symbol. Okay. And that's my query. And I hope soon after I save this, it will tell me if there are any errors with this, and immediately I can see one. But if it saves successfully, that means there are no errors. And how can I test it whether it's really working? I can run it here inside the Visual Studio itself. As you see, I'm actually not going to another tool to do any database operations. So I'm doing all the database operations within the Visual Studio. So that's the one of the advantage using the Visual Studio. Okay, so I can execute that stored proc, and it opened a dialog. And if you have ever worked with other tools like a Benthic or like SQL Loader and other things, executing the stored procs is one of the biggest hurdle. You have to write an exec and follow the stored proc name and the parameters and do all the stuff. In Visual Studio, it's a luxury. You will get used to it. And right click, and I have this beautiful UI wherein I can key in the text. In this case, I'll just say test department, and HOD I'll say 100 something, and location known one, I think 30, or even I can leave them null, that shouldn't be a big deal. And the error, the zero rows returned. I'll see, let me see if it is successful. I can straight away go and query. That's the easiest way, I would say. It did not. There is some exception, I see. Let me refresh this just to double check. No. So the insert did not happen. Conflicted with the foreign key. We have the referential integrity wherein the department, the employee ID, whatever I keyed in is not valid. So I have to go back and see what is a valid employee ID. I don't have 100, that's why it broke. So I will put something other than that. It's good, the referential integrity is working good. And we'll run again with the valid data. Oops, I think I picked the wrong one. Yeah, create department. Okay, so in this case, let me change this value back to say 101, and I hope 30 is there. And in this case, yes, I see a one row got affected. That means it's successful. And I'll just refresh this. Yes, we have this record created. So this is a record that's added just now. Okay, good. So we're able to successfully create a record using a stored proc. Our database portion is done. But of course, we also need another stored proc for updating that same thing. So we're going to create the same again. We create another one with say update department. And again, another FYI information. Although I'm doing all this in the local with followed my native database file, I can do the same thing with the SQL Server database also. So this is the case where I'm actually, this database is to the SQL Server database file, and I can connect to that and do all this as usual. But I can, of course, if you have a SQL Server Studio installed, then you can do the same thing there as well. You have more features there than the Visual Studio. Okay, so I can't really type while talking, so I will stop talking for now and concentrate on the code. So for updating, so instead of really typing the whole thing again, what I'm going to do is really copy the signature that I already have here. And paste it in the, well, updating the one new thing here is I need to get the ID as well. So I need to have an additional parameter for getting the ID. So I'm going to add that ID, and that's going to be int, because we know that's an identity column. And begin, in this case, update the table name, department, set, I'm going to again do the same thing, set, oops, name is equal to variable, and another one, HOD is equal to HOD variable, and the location is equal to @ location. Okay, so again, of course, update, if you do this statement, then it's going to update for all the records. So I need to add where clause, where ID is equal to @ID. So this is my update statement. Okay, let's try to save this. It did not crib, so there is no syntax errors. I'm going to run this code, and again see the same thing. Of course, before I run this, I would like to, of course, this is going to be a model dialog, so I can't go back and see the last ID that I saved, and try to use a 16 here and try to update that record by running this stored proc. Okay, good. So I'm passing the 16 as an ID, and the name in this case, let me think of a very good name. What is the best name I can? I'll say entertainment. And HOD, I'll say, I'll change this to 105 and the location to 25. Okay. So it says one row affected, which is good. I'll just refresh this and I have my data modified. So which is good, I have my latest changes in. So with this, my database portion for managing the department table is done. So as part of department, we already know there is an address, right? So for address, since we already done for the address while doing for employee, and I have the create employee, where is the create employee? Yep. As part of create employee, we did the create address as well. We have the same storebook done, and also we have an update address also. Okay, and that's the advantage that you gain when you make it a very modular way. And in this case, since I have already done for address, I don't have to redo that for department again. So that's the biggest advantage you'll see. So I can able to reuse that same components across any place. So that's one beauty. Good. So we are done with the database. So we'll go. What's the immediate next layer? Where is our sequence diagram? I always want to go back and refer to it because we are going from bottom up. In this case, our stored proc is done. So next immediate tier is the data access component, which is the data access layer. So we will go and implement the data access layer. So data access layer is here, DAL. Within that, we have a department DAC. Again, the same principle. We have completely separated each one of them so that I can reuse them the way I want it. Tailor them and reuse the way I want it. So in this case, department has its own data access layer. And we know that we have an interface that we are making use of it, which has a certain members called create, delete. All the CRUD operations are part of the department data access tier component implementation. This get will get you the single department. We haven't implemented that, so we'll down the line we'll do it, and update. So what we're going to do today is, again, update we're going to implement that. We have a stored proc. Now in data access layer, what we're going to do here is make use of the enterprise library. Okay, if you're using the AWS.NET, again, so enterprise library, what is the benefit of using enterprise library versus using the AWS.NET? And I'm actually not showing you the AWS.NET part of database access. It is pretty similar. Only thing is AWS.NET, whenever you implement, you either implement that to target to a respective databases, either SQL Server database, an Oracle database, or say anything else. So they have their own respective data providers, which you have to implement that. So the advantage of having enterprise library on board is that you don't have to write a code specific to a given database. So that's one biggest advantage. Down the line, if you consider I'm writing a product which can talk to an Oracle database or a SQL Server database, depends upon the client's request, I can easily do that using enterprise library. So I don't have to go and write change any of the line of code. It's going to be a very generic model, and it can be configured to talk to any database provider. So that's the advantage of having enterprise library on board. And okay, so how I'm going to make use of enterprise library? Okay, there is a lot of stuff before I set up this project to consume the enterprise library. I think this is the right time to talk about that. An enterprise library is an open source tool, and it's free. Once you have the, if you go to Google, in other words, if you have to actually go to CodePlex, CodePlex.com is the open source community for Microsoft.NET, and I can search for enterprise library. Here comes the 5.0. And once you go there, you can see the downloads. This is a community edition, but there you'll have a download link somewhere wherein you can actually download that. Where can I go get the download one? I could always go back to probably Google and come back there. That's the easiest way, I think. Okay, so Enterprise Library costs you nothing. It's free, it's an open source thing. It comes along with the source code. So once you download this Enterprise Library, you'll get a lot of things on your plate. So once you go back here and download this stuff and install the MSI, what it's going to do is it's going to get you the source code as well as the components that you need to consume in your application. So I'm just going to give you a quick recap on how I set it up on my machine. And I actually did it here. So Enterprise Library, this is a source files. It has the complete set of source code. You can actually modify the source code the way you want it, customize it, and reuse it. It also comes with the built-in test projects. So once you change your code, you can run these test projects. All these are test projects. And as you see, this is an open source. I don't want to open this and again consume a lot of time. So that's the keynote for you, is that it's an open source. Once you download it, you'll get the source code along with the compiled binaries. Either you can go ahead and use the compiled binaries directly, or if you want to customize it, you can customize it. So you have both the flexibilities. Okay, so in this case, we're not going to go and customize it. We're going to use the distributable components that are coming out of box, which were actually installed somewhere in the program files. Let me see, Enterprise Library. I always forget these paths where they normally, or Microsoft, yes, here you go, it's under 64, and the compile binaries will be part of the, once you install the MSI, it's going to put the required files into the bin. And along with the DLLs, it also comes with a very rich editors, and this is the latest thing in 5.0 version. It came with a very good editor. Earlier, there were GUIs to configure the respective components into your system, but they were not that intuitive and they were not complete, saying that there's a lot of stuff you have to go back and configure in the configuration side. But with these Enterprise Library Config EXEs, they are very much integrated within your Visual Studio. So once you download it, once you install the MSI, what are you going to get in addition to your IDE is your editor integration. So this is the this context menu item is added up once you do the MSI, and this will launch the configuration tool directly. Okay, so all this I'm showing because I'm using the Enterprise Library Data Access application block along with a couple of other application blocks. And once you go here, if it is a brand new configuration, you have to go to the blocks. So each of the module is termed as a block inside the Enterprise Library, and I can make use of all of these. The caching application block, you can configure it to do a caching. You can cache it to any data source, you can map it to a database, or you can map it to a given server. A lot of things that you can do for which you have to ideally write a lot of code. So this is already readily available. You can just configure it and make use of it. Okay, in our application, what I did make use of is the database application blocks. This is the data settings, and application settings is added up, and exception handling, logging, and the validation, the VAB base. This is called the VAB, V-A-B. In other words, how industry normally looks at these are like, it goes like this in short form. This is referred to as a VAB, which is called as a validation application block, and data access application block. And in this case, this is for data. It's referred to as data access application blocks. It's called a DAB. So you might see these are some of the keywords that you might see in the industry. And similarly, for exception handling application blocks, EHAB or simply EAB, people refer to, and the for logging, LAB, logging application block. So the and similarly for caching application block, you can rationalize how they would name like. And of course, there is a policy injection application block. There's a cryptography of this for completely security. If you want to do encryptions and implement the security using this, is a cryptography is completely for encryptions, and security is more than the encryption, but both of them use internally, intermediately, exchangeably, they can use each of them, in which case for exception handling and logging, they go side by side. So whenever there's an exception handled, you might want to log that exception. So we are actually using that interchangeably, both of them. And similarly, the cryptography and security also goes hand by side by side. You can explore more of this, and this is code-wise, it is just 1% of the code, but most of the time you will need to understand the configuration. That's one basic problem with the enterprise library. The configuration-wise, because of the flexibility, it has a ton of configuration. So everything is driven through configuration. In this case, a database application block, what I did is nothing, just have to configure the database. In this case, I already have the database configuration set up. Expand this, and you can implement the, okay, this is one of the configuration that I added up, and the connection string is, again, I did not like one thing here. Instead of, it usually expects me to get the connection string and then paste it here and then say okay. Instead, it would have given me a tool to go and do the connection string just like your universal data connection that you can do using the apps. It is not a wizard driven. So that's one thing I did not like, but otherwise, once you get the connection string, you just have to configure this. In this way, I did not see it's a very great intuitive, but again, as I said, you can actually configure various databases, in this case general databases or Oracle connections or the custom database, anything that you want to configure. Okay, this is what we're going to use in our database, and at this point I'm going to stop with the database. At this point there's nothing more than just a database connection. Okay, once I did this, what it's going to do is it's going to go back and update my web.config, and again we will come back to this tool when we talk about the exception handling, logging and validations. Okay, at this point we restrict this point to database settings. Okay, as I showed you, it has nothing more than just database configuration, in which the default database is configured to HR application DB connection. Okay, in addition I have more, but again, if you really want to create a new database connection, it's again, you hit the plus and add database string, and it's it doesn't have much of information, but you can say the database connection, you can just have to copy and paste the connection string here and say okay, and also so database provider, which one you want to pick the provider, and that's all it takes, otherwise nothing else. It's not too hard. You can also do this from config file also. Okay, so I'm not going to save any of this information. I'm going to say no, because I'm good with what I have. We already walked through the connection route. Right now we are back to data access component. Now how to consume the enterprise library? So for that, again, as I referred to you, that there are compiled assemblies which were sitting in the bin directory here. So what I did is I copied the respective DLLs that I need for enterprise library. Of course, the enterprise library dot data is the key one that I need to import, and respectively for exception handling, I need to again exception handling and exception handling logging, both I need to know, I need to have in my thing, and also I have logging. So what all I need, I'm actually going to import them into my add my reference to my project. So, and I already did all of that. What I did here is I just copied them to a local path called entlib50. Okay, that was 50. So I just copied all those DLLs here, although they are sitting in a different place, because I want to, as part of my deployment, I want these files to be deployed, and I don't want to keep it in a common area if someone want to mess it up. So I just added up as a local reference and added those references to my data access layer, and we know how to add a reference to them. Okay, so these are the references that I already added. In my data access layer, I am using the data and also exception logging and the common. Common is a common thing that goes along with all the other tasks, so it normally required to get in. Okay, so once I added reference to that, I'm going to of course use my using statement to use it. And using Microsoft.practices.enterpriselibrary.data. So this is what I need to do my DAB, which is Data Access Application Block. And once I do that, what is that I need? So in this case, I'm not going to make use of this constructor. I'm going to get rid of it. And remember, this is the code as is that is created by my Enterprise Architect tool. And I did do a couple of tweaks there, here and there, as you know. I fixed the errors that are generated out of the Enterprise Architect model, and I able to do this stuff. And now I'm going to implement the body of the respective interfaces. This create new, again, is part of my interface that I'm implementing here. Okay, let's go to definition and see what all it has. It has all of these, create new, delete, get collection, and update. So I'm implementing first one of them, which is create new. So now what is the code that I need to write? To make a call, so what I'm going to do here is to get the information from the application and pass that information to the database using the StoredFrog. Okay, so how I'm going to do that? I'm going to start with the database. Database, and I'll say DB, just to keep it simple, is equal to database factory. So this is a factory pattern. If you know, that's fine, otherwise no. It's a factory pattern implementation wherein the it's going to create the instance of the respective database that's configured to your web.config. In this case, I can simply say create database and leave it. In this case, what will happen is it's going to pick the default database that is already configured here. In this case, the default database is already mapped to use HR application DB. Okay, so this is the default database. If I don't pass the database name, it's going to make use of the default database and create it. Otherwise, I can also pass the respective database to use. Okay, in this case, I am going to make it specific, although this is the default one. I am going to pass this to the database. So in ADO.NET, to just to create a database connection, then you have to actually create a connection object and then pass the connection string, or the similarly the same way the connection, whatever connection name that you have, that you can pass it to create a connection. It's the same concept there also. And before I go further, the way I normally like to code is try to see the errors are always zero. Okay, so in this case, since I removed this throw new, it's actually cribbing. If you see, this is actually cribbing because I have to return the value out. So what I normally do is, instead of going ahead, I normally say, create a variable that can be written out. Okay, in this case, another thing here I see that this specific qualifier is actually too long here. I want to instead go ahead and make it available at the namespace references so that I don't have to write it every time. And in this case, I'll say dictionary of int. Why it's dictionary of int and string? Because the return type of my call is a dictionary of int and string. And hope you remember, this is a generic dictionary that is taking of type int and string data types. And this I deliberately added to again make reuse of our concepts of generics that we have invested in, and we are making use of it to return the collection of errors that I'm going to have. The color errors, I'm looking that error as a with error code and a message. Okay, and of course I have to return that, so that's why I'm having a local variable with the same name, sorry, same data type, dictionary of int and string. Okay, And of course I have to return this at the bottom. And now hope my errors are gone. Good. So this is the first step I normally do so that the errors are not going to confuse me and disturb me all the time, and also I satisfy my return type. And now I fill the blob body so that I satisfy what is that I'm going to return out. Okay, good. So now I have created the database instance. What is the next step I need to do? So I need two things here. I need to execute a stored proc in the database. For that I need a database, and also the second thing, I need the command. This is the same concept that applies back, all the way back to the AWO.NET. For AWO.NET also you need to have the command, the database, and of command object, the database instance, and of course the stored proc. Map the stored proc name and the parameters to the command and then fire it in the database. That's as simple as that. And in this case the command, and that's called db command. And I don't see the db command appearing here because I don't have the reference to it. And there is another shortcut to add a reference to it. Once I know that there is a class name called db command and I did not add a reference to it in the namespace, what I can do is I can type it up and control and period operator. You can say control and period operator, then I can have the hint saying, okay, this is the namespace you want to add. And once I'm sure, I can just click it. It's going to add the namespace there. So it's easy. Once you're used to it, you can actually write, you make use of it and write the code much faster. And cmd is equal to, in this case, I'm going to create an instance of a command, but that command need to be associated to the database, right? Database dot get stored proc command. So because I'm trying to make a call to the stored proc, I'm creating a stored proc command, and what this is going to take is a stored proc name. I just wanted to zoom up here. Yeah, it's going to take one parameter which is called a stored proc name, and the stored proc name is a string, right? So what I'm going to do is, just to avoid any further trouble, I want to copy the stored proc name because I don't want to type it and see that because I misspell the name, it's cribbing down the line and waste some time in doing research and finding why. So I would always love to do this, which is good. And I created the command now, and what's the next step? I need to add the parameters to the stored proc. Of course, the stored proc needs only two things. One is a stored proc name and the parameters to it. And what I'm going to do here is add the parameters. And add the parameters to the database, database dot add in. And if you see, there is a in and out parameters in our application. We are actually, in this case, we are not using out parameters. Otherwise, if I have an out parameter, I also need to add the add out parameter, which is the case I did for employee database, wherein we have to get the ID. I will quickly go back to that part as well after finishing this. Add in parameter, and of course the command cmd, and the this is the name of the parameter that we're going to pass. And if I expand and see what are the parameters my create department stored proc's taking, it's taking name. Okay, it's going to take at the rate symbol and the data type of the respective one. In this case, the name is a varchar, and for db type, this is the same case here. I don't have this already referred to. It's already suggesting me to use the system.dbType, but in this case, what I'm going, dype, my typo, and I'm going to make use of the same thing using statement, and it's going to take care of that one. Okay, string. And the value. So value is actually coming from where? It's actually coming as an input parameter to my create new. But if you take a close look at this, as part of a design, this is a very generic high-level class, which is a HR domain base. Okay, what I need to do is, I know that whoever is going to pass the value to this call, they always ensure that they pass only for department, because this is a department DSC. Okay, what I'm going to do is, now I need to gain that here, and I create an instance of department is equal to HR domain base, sorry, the parameter HR. This is the parameter that I'm getting in. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to use here, but of course this is not going to be working, because if you see the exception again, this roots back to your skills of the inheritance hierarchy, the language specific stuff. What it's trying to say here is cannot implicitly convert type HR domain base class to department, although we know that the department is actually inheriting from the HR domain base class. How do I know? I can go back to my configuration here, and we see that it is actually inheriting from HR domain base class and also implementing the iBusiness rules interface. So this is all the way back to our basics of object-oriented programming principles. This is inheritance. Since it is falling within the same root, that means it's a child of HR domain base class, I can be able to typecast it back to department. Okay, and this time it should be good. But only thing we need to make sure that whoever makes the call to this department DAC.createNew, they always ensure that they pass the department. If they pass anything else, this this typecast will definitely going to break. Okay, that's the key thing we need to know. And of course, we can, if you want to make this design much more strong, then what we can enforce here is we can make this create new accepted generic. This is a generic signature wherein people can also enforce the generics rule to pass only the types, given specific type as an input parameter, so that that will be a very type safe call, so that people cannot pass anything else other than the department. So that way you can enforce it. So we're not going to that level, but at this point we are pretty good. So we got the department object. That means the data that is coming into this call is part of the OBJ department. And what I'm going to do is pass that information to my parameter dot name. Okay, so that's how we have to make these in parameters. I'm going to create two separate copies, and also HOD, another one is the location. Okay, so location is again just an ID. These two are actually of type integers in database, so I need to make this as int32. So there are a couple of things that you need to definitely consider with respect to data type, otherwise once the database call is made, it's going to fail. And in my case, it's a head for HOD, and this is a location. Again, location is one specific thing here. As part of a domain object model, my location is actually, what is that? My location is of type address, okay? But in my database, my location is actually reference type, which is of just a referring to the ID in the address database, right? So in this case, what I have to pass here is not location, but the location ID. Okay, and again, one beauty here is ID is a very common attribute for all of my domain object model, and that's the reason where this ID is located. We'll see. If I go to definition, the ID is actually part of the domain base class. Okay, so HR domain base class, we have the ID, and if you remember the question mark here, this is a nullable type. We did talk about the nullable types. What it means is nullable types, if you can make the value types also, you can assign a null to a value types in simple. Okay, that's a nullable type. Why I made this nullable type? Because I'm actually interacting with the database. So whenever I'm interacting with the database, when I pass a value like this, I don't really want to check whether this, because in .NET language, the default value for ID, if I don't assign, is zero. But in database terms, the default, if we're not assigning anything, it's a null. So that's a key difference when we talk to the database versus the programming language. And to substantiate that difference, I'm actually making my ID as a nullable type, so that I'm going to explicitly assign, whenever I'm not assigning a value, I'm going to assign a null to it directly, so that the null is transformed to a database null when I make a database call. So perfectly makes sense, and that's where the nullable types are advantages. So that's again a very important good point that you want to remember down the line if someone asks what is a nullable type and how can you use it, when can we use it. So this is an ideally good example when we deal with the database. Okay, so in this case my code is very simple. I don't have to really check if ID is equal to 0 then or pass the DB null. We can also do the DB null also here. So this is an this is a DB null that you're going to pass. Otherwise I'm not actually doing that. I'm straight away making it a nullable type and then passing it directly. The rest of the things should be taken care of. Good. So once I'm done with my parameters set here, what is the next immediate thing I need to do is I need to invoke the stored proc command inside the database. So that's the last thing I should do. That again goes back to db.execute non-query. Non-query why? Again non-query will take a command cmd. In this case when you say execute anything, there are a couple of options here. When you say this is again same to ado.net, and don't consider that I'm not covering ado.net because this is ado.net. In other words, in ado.net also you have to create, but the only thing is the objects that you create are a little different. If you're dealing with the SQL Server database, you always want to go with the system.data.sql client and then create the SQL connection and of course SQL command. They are specific to the database. In other words, when I'm dealing with the enterprise library, they are very much generic. I'm not actually pinpoint or write any code specific to any given database. As you see, there is nothing like a SQL client or Oracle, nothing like that. It's a very generic form. So that I can switch over to any database from the configuration side instead of the code. So that's a big advantage you're getting. And again, with respect to the database instance, you will see several. To see that, I think the best way I could do is the database, go to the definition of the database. And yes, come down here. Yes, I wanted to actually walk you through the several execute commands that we have. In this case, the data execute dataset. This is the command that you will choose only when the command that the stored proc that you are associating is returning an output. In our case, it's not returning anything. In other words, if stored proc has a SQL statement at the end, select statement, then that's when you're going to use this. In which case, the output of the stored proc is transformed into a dataset in the code. Okay, I don't have an example to demonstrate that for now, but that you can actually give it a try. All you need to do is go to the stored proc and create a stored proc that actually returns something and do this. Yeah, I think we can do that as well as part of the get employee. We actually did that. Yes, I already have a code for get, in which case the get stored proc is having a select statement. And I did made use of the execute dataset. Okay, so that's part of it. And execute non-query is the one that we're going to make use of it when the query is not returning, the stored proc is not returning anything, and it's but doing some operation behind the scene, and but might have a return types, return out parameters. That's fine. So in which case, we're going to make use of the non-query, and execute reader is similar to execute dataset. Only the difference is that it's going to return an iData reader, which is going to maintain a live data connection. So that the big difference between the dataset and iData reader is that the dataset will close the connection soon after it returns the data, whereas iData reader is going to be maintaining the connection. So it's always advised to be cautious whenever you decide to use an execute reader. Okay, and as a matter of fact, as a best practice, try to avoid using the iData reader. And if at all you use it, you always need to explicitly close that once you're done. Okay, I'm just quickly running through all these options. Okay, I don't want to actually really, we don't have even that time to cover each one of the everything of them. And execute scalar is the one that if your stored proc is actually returning a single value out, then you can make use of the execute scaler. So those are the four main things, calls that are available as part of the database connection. That's again specific or common to the AWS.NET, nothing specific to the enterprise library. So in this case, since my stored proc is not returning any value out, I'm using the execute not query. Okay, done. So this is my data access layer implementation. I am done with this. Okay, and similarly, since we are done and walked through each line of this code, what I can do immediately is I can double check again and couple of things I have forgotten here is I want to try to handle exception and also dispose the command soon after I invoke this. So how can I do that? The best way to do the dispose is using statement. You remember that we have talked about the using statement as part of the basics, wherein the using statement, whenever you make use of that statement, within the scope of it, once the object is done, it's going to ensure that its dispose is called. In this case, that's the ideal scenario wherein you want to make use of the dispose thing. And there's another shortcut here in Visual Studio to just to select, if I want to include the whole thing into an using statement, then I just have to select that state, the whole block, and say Control KS, and I'll see this code snippet window, and I'm going to pick the using and hit tab. It's going to give me the block, the whole using thing, and I just have to move my command into this using. So that's again a code tip for you. You can make use of these snippets. And another thing I want to do is I want to add the whole thing into my try catch, and that also I can do the same way. And in this case, what I'm going to do is where I can actually start from the beginning and select the whole thing except the return value. Yeah, and I'll do the same thing, Control KS and try and hit double. So it's that easy and quick. If you're a fast programmer, then these code snippets is going to really help you fly your coding skills faster. I am not a very fast programmer. I'm a bit very slow guy. I'm trying to be fast. And in this case, of course, the exception handling. Right, when I do this again, this is one of the again, I don't want to stop doing this in other ways. Whenever you do exception handling, you have a couple of things here. If I handle this exception here, I want to make sure that the exception is not handled anywhere else. So that's one thing. If you're normally an exception bubbles up from bottom to the first caller. So you can handle the exception, ideally speaking, at the top layer, so that you have the complete exception stack trace, and it's easy to read through your exception. And in my case, I have been using this exception handling at multiple places. In which case, ideally happens is that you will see the multiple entries of the same exception log multiple times. So in this case, I don't really want to worry about that best practices part. I'm actually going to just show you how to make use of the exception handling using the exception handling application block. For that, why do I go and do this? I can actually go and use my code snippets, shortcuts. What I'm going to do is here, exception policy, I don't see it here because that namespace is not included. I'm going to say control period operator, and I'll see this, and I added it up. So that as simple as that, and say handle exception, and of course I need to take care of the EX part. By default it's not provided. I'll pass the exception that it needs to handle and the exception policy. Probably this is the time I would like to go and jump and show you the policies that I'm having. For now, to finish off this line of code, I'm actually going to pass the default, because that's the default application exception policy that I have created. In other words, I actually did create constant for this. So that's again, remember, that's one of the best practice to do is anything that is any static value that can be reused or is being reused at multiple places in the application, is the best way to do is create a constant for that. Okay, and I did have a constant created for this, and that's part of my helper module within the helper class here. I did have this constants file, and I have the constant created here inside the helper. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make use of this namespace inside my DSC. If it is not added, if it's not added, I want to keep this little organized here. Just doing some kind of housekeeping work here to keep things organized. Okay. And again, I don't want to spend too much of time there, but that's what I do normally. Okay, good. So using my HR project dot the helper, that's what I'm trying to refer to. And within that, I have a constants static class constants dot, I have an call exception policy for which I'm trying to use that. Okay, and let me make sure, go back and see, if you take a close look at the constants, it's a static class. And again, one of the language features that we are using here, and again recapping on why we would like to do a static class in this case. So this is the ideal typical scenario where you would like to use a static class, because the static constants that I'm making use of within this class, I don't want to really create an instance of this constants class and then access the constants within it, or access any helper classes. In ideally, in the helper classes, if you situations like this, just want to keep my constants into one place so that I can reuse them at multiple places, and as part of the .NET wise it goes, there's nothing that can sit in air. They all have to get into a class. So we have to have a class, but I don't want to create instance of it and then call the class. Instead, I would like to make the class itself as static so that I can refer to the members of the static class by their name instead of their instance. So that's the reason why I made the constants class a static. That's a good example wherein you can make use of the static class. Okay, good. So we are done. And in addition to that, of course, what the default exception policy does. Okay, this is the time I would like to take you to the next step of exception, wherein I'm going to say check it out just in case, because when I do any changes to the configuration, it would like to write it to it, and if it is not checked out, it might create more trouble. So now I'm going to go back to the Enterprise Library Configuration tool and walk you through the exceptions handling settings. The settings within the exception handling, the policy I have here is a default, and that's what exactly name I'm actually making use of within the policy. Okay, that's the relationship from my code. And if I can have multiple other policies, what is a policy in general? So exceptions in general, I would like to handle, in this case, I'm actually handling all exceptions in this policy. But whereas you can actually differentiate which type of exception you want to treat which way. You can actually differentiate it that way. In this case, I did all, but you can also write your own exception types by using the plus add policy, and you can provide a policy name here. It says my policy, and then add exceptions that you want to do, and you can specify the post handling mechanism. There are three types of post handling mechanisms, and in which case, the default case, I have none. Okay, and either I can also choose notify rethrow or throw new exception. In which case, notify rethrow is the option that you would like to pick when you want to handle the exception by another area. Wherein what this is going to do is, in addition of handling the exception and log or do whatever you configure as part of the handlers, you have the next tab, you have a handler, so how you want to handle it. In addition to that, it's also going to notify another process indicating that the exception has happened. Okay, in which you can configure another process like an emailing mechanism or any third-party tool mechanism that you want to invoke based on the exception. Okay, so that's the way you can make use of it. Another way is the throw new exception, which is going to actually encapsulate your exception into another exception so that the end user will see a different exception instead of showing the actual exception, that you can actually wrap it off. So that's about these post handling mechanism. This is a very key thing at the baseline. And the next important thing is the handlers. You can add the add handlers, and you can pick any of these handlers, and in which case I would like to walk you through what the handlers available. Like in this case, what I've used is the logging exception handler. In which case, what this is going to do is, it's going to log to any persistent store. In my case, I can choose the persistent store to be a flat file or a database or also initiation state. You can actually pick and choose where you want to put that log. In our case, as I showed you earlier, I did choose to have it as a flat file. And the flat file, again, you can actually make it as a plain flat file or an XML file also. And also you can write a binary file as well. So you have a lot of other options that you want to mix and match. And in our case, we actually use the rolling listener. The rolling head listener is a special case wherein it actually rolls off. We'll see that in just a few minutes. And custom exception handler, you can write your own exception handler and attach to it so that that process will take in care. And the fault contract exception handler, this is specific to the services. We are going to see the WCF services or in the next session, and that time we will see the fault, what is a fault specific to the services. And the replace handler is going to write the replace handler, which is again a custom hook that you can attach to it, and a wrap handler is also similar to it. So in our demo, we're going to see the logging exception handler. Okay, so I don't want to again go and create a new one here. So that's how you can actually add a policies. And again, another key thing here is all exceptions, right? That you can actually change it to handle a specific exception of your type. In this case, it's handling the system.exception. As you see, this is the base of all exceptions, right? So you can actually handle, for example, system.exception or arithmetic exception. So type of exceptions you want to treat a different way, that you can do it. And if you remember, we did talk about the custom exceptions, creating a custom exception. Typically, what if at all your application is a very robustly designed to handle exceptions at a very best level, then what you can do is have your own custom exceptions created for each of your modules. In which case, I'll have an exception, custom exception, which says that my HR project dot exceptions dot DOM. And all the exceptions that happens within my data access layer will return an exception called my DOM exceptions. And similarly, data access layer exception and the BWL exception. In that case, you can actually pick and choose or define a different policies that targets the respective exception, again exception type, if you say add exception type, you can actually pick the exception type within this tool. In this case, I'll pick add from file. Yeah, you can actually pick the exception from within this XML exception, and this this type you can actually handle it the way you want it. In this case, I can add another handler for that type. So whenever the system sees that that specific exception is thrown, then the respective handler is going to be mapped to. So you can imagine what level of flexibility you have in handling exception. And all of this is driven just by configuration settings only. And with 5.0, with such a great tool to do that, it's really, there's no reason for you to say no for it. And also, it's free. and you can actually download it, freely use it, and it's available for you to even modify, customize the code to where you want to implement it. So what else you want? So that's the biggest advantage with enterprise library application handling. And in this case, I'm not going to go that far. So that level you can do. In our case, what I did is I have only one policy, and all the exceptions are routed through that policy, where it's actually handling all exception, which is of a base type, and I'm picked the post handler as none, so that it's not going to redo any special things. So once it's handled, and it's going to just handle that exception, route it to the logging exception handler, and keep quiet. It's not going to throw it again and say, okay, something happened, take care of it. So that's the default nature of an exception. And this handler, we'll take a look at the handler now. And the formatter type, I have a formatter type chosen, which is the formatter is how the exception need to be written out, and which formatter that you're going to use to handle your exception. And by default, those are added up by default, and what you need to really worry about is which are the listeners that you want to add. This is a logging category. In this case, I picked two listeners. One is a database listener, which is going to write to the database. But again, as I said, these listeners are part of the logging application block. Okay, this is nothing to do with the exception. As I said, both of them sit side by side, and in this case, this listener is coming from the logging application side, because I choose to have a logging exception handler. Okay, good. So we'll see how to configure these two from the logging side. Okay, and what else? And rest all things are by default. You can actually pick and choose the severity and the priority. You can also add filters to a couple of exceptions. For example, you specify a particular priority or severity to the application exception, and then filter out by adding a filters, so that you don't want to handle this severity exceptions in this way. You can also even redirect based on the severity also, or handle certain exception not to be logged anywhere. You can do that way also. It's very rich flexibility wise. And of course, since we have gone to the logging exception handler, we also would like to come back here and take a look at the logging settings. And in this case, I use the general logging, and where in category wise, I just picked the general and added two listeners here. One is a database listener. Again, it is using a database connection called logging DB, and this database configuration we have seen, and this logging DB is actually making connection to the database, SQL Server database. And of course, for me to use the database trace listener, I also have to set up the database. That's one hurdle. And to set up the database, how can I do? Again, before I go and show you that part, we'll finish off this part. It is actually making use of the database stored proxy here. Okay, so this is the add category. This is the stored proc. If you see the tooltip there, the name of the stored proc in the database, that's going to do the add category. Either you can create your own stored proc and do it yourself, but enterprise library comes with a built-in one, and we'll see the built-in stored proc. And of course, it's using a SQL client connection, and of course that stored proc can be in any database. It can be, you can map it to a Oracle database as well, which is going to work fine. And the text formatter, this is a formatter that's going to be used to log what content you want to bring in. You can pick and choose the formatter also. Of course, the formatter is configured here. You can add the log formatter, and in this case I added in a text formatter. You also have binary and custom log formatters. Okay, this is where you can choose to have the binary as well. Okay, so this part, this is the database part, wherein I have a database instance name and the stored procs that are, this is by default. I did not add anything. Okay, only thing I added here is the database that I picked. But this database, how to create? Once you have this MSI installed, let me recollect where it is. I think it is under the blocks, and not validation. It's the logging. Where is the logging? Can I see logging? Exception handling. Yep, logging is here. Why I can't able to see that? Okay, within that I have a database trace listener, and within that I have a scripts. So within this I have this create logging database command, which is actually making use of a command shell command, which is going to use of the OSSQL. This OSSQL is the command line shell command, wherein which you, using which you can handle or manage the SQL Server database. And in this case, really don't want to get into too deep of it. This comes as part of your MSI itself. And what I'm going to do here is to just to before I run that, I want just wanted to quickly connect to this database and see that we already have entries in this database. Okay, so there's a lot of logging happening today. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to disconnect this, because once I run that command, it's actually going to try to connect to this database and create the database all of from the scratch. So that's what the first thing you will do is, once you have the database set up, all you need to do is just come to this place and hit this. What it's going to internally do is it's going to actually run this code, this SQL, and the SQL is using the master database, and also it's actually dropping the logging database prior it's running if it is existing. So there's no point, there's no problem if you already have, of course, if you already have a database configured and run this, you will lose the database. It's going to drop it and then create a new one. Okay, so in this case I really don't care. I can rerun this command because all I have is a test database, and it successfully created the database. That's what I presume. And I'm going to connect to this database again, refresh this. Okay, it just refreshed, and if it did correctly, then I shouldn't see any of this data. Yes, everything is gone. It's a brand new database created for me now, and with the same settings. And once I set that database, I can just go back and just configure, connect to the respective database, and you're all set to go. And the rolling flat file trace listener, it's really interesting, and this is what you will definitely need in any production environment, wherein the log file, you can prefer, you can choose where you want to log it, and if the file already exists, what rolling itself talks about is that if the file, you can actually configure the file to create a new file once it meets a certain criteria. It could be based on the roll size, in this case 100 KB, or roll interval, in this case for every minute, just for our demo sake. You can also pick a monthly or weekly or daily. Ideally, the best fit is a daily. You can this daily again starts like 24 hours from the day the first file is created. It's not like your clockwise day. It's going to take the 24 hours from the day the first file is created. For example, if the file is created today afternoon, then the new file will be created tomorrow afternoon. Okay, it's going to count the 24 hours like that. Okay, so that's the interval you can pick, and based on the size also you can roll it. What happens ideally is if you want to have a exception log, you're writing into one file, eventually if there are a lot of exceptions coming in or flooding into the file size is going to grow drastically down the line. And you don't want to do that, because that exception logging itself become a very big bottleneck for your application. So for that to happen, you use the rolling flat file listener, which will roll up based on the certain size limit, so that you can archive the older files to a different place, or even you can leave it there if you have the disk space. But only thing is your file IO operation will go down, because it always tries to work with only a small file size. Okay, so that's the advantage you get with the rolling flat file listener. And the output we have already seen in my folder, ctemp logs. So this is how it's rolling up based on the date, and it's incrementing if the file already exists. Okay, and it's working perfectly, and that's the option I picked. If the file exists, increment it, otherwise overwrite it. You can also pick that option, and that's part of the rolling flat file listener. And what else you have here, you have so many other things. There's no end for customization here. You can do an email. If an exception happens, you can send it to as an email. You can add it to the event log. That's as part of your system event log. You can add it to a flat file, in which case it will not be doing a rolling. It's going to add to the same file every time. And message queue, if you have MSM queue, you can add it to that. This rolling flat file listener is what we are using right now. And system diagnosis, trace listener, this is again an interesting one. If you want to write diagnostic logs to your application, you can make use of this, wherein you need to use the trace.writeline. Trace.writeline is a command that you're going to use to write a log to a flat file, which can, in generally, where you can make use of it is if at all you want to track if the users have logged in, what are the pages they are walking through, all that kind of statistical information that you can make use of it, the diagnostic trace, and that information can be available as a flat file, which you can make use of it. And of course, XML trace listener, which you can make use to write the XML files. So there's a lot of scope for you to pick and choose from the logging application blog. Okay, so I hope you're convinced that Enterprise Library is a very, very powerful one. And for the current, since everything else is working good, I don't want to really save this. I want to quit without saving, to be safe. Okay, so we have covered a lot about the exception or enterprise library now with this one line of statement. Okay, we'll come back to our data access layer. And in this case, I'm obliged to actually return an errors, in which case an exception happens. Not only logging, I also have to report it back. I report it back by using my return value, return.add. The message that is key, I will say some 999 key. This time I don't really care because we're not really writing a production code here. Otherwise, you might have respect to error codes predefined that you can pick it from either from a different resource file or a constant file. Either way, it's fine. In our case, 999 represent that something happened in the database. Good. So this brings my create new implemented well. Now I'm going to copy this whole thing, put it to my update as well, because nothing else will change except couple of them. Another tip here is if you're lucky to get into a project where everything is done for you, nothing you have to worry about, then of course you can choose the second option that I just picked, copy the old one, paste it here, and change the respective one, in this case the update. But of course for that you need to know what to change, obviously. And in this case we have a new parameter called the ID. Right, for update we have a new parameter, so I'm going to add the ID here, and it's going to be int 32. Life without IntelliSense is really miserable, right? Good. So that's what I need to do, and again execute it. So that's as simple as it. Once I did one part of it, the other part is copy-paste. And I hope I did not miss anything here. If at all I missed something, then no problem. The runtime errors will tell me. Good. Now I have done with my data access layer implementation. Now we're going to quickly jump into the next immediate layer, which is the BWC. We will go back to the BWC, BWL. Here I have the department. Again, this is a brand new one. There's nothing here. This is just a code skeleton we have. We are going to make use of, okay. I'm just going to check out, okay. Create new. What needs to happen here? Obviously, what needs to happen here is we have to make use of the respective data access component and call that, as simple as that. To do that, I need to have another thing that I need to include using my HR project and the data access layer. That's what I need that. And in this case, again, the same fundamental thing I would like to always do, which is start with, of course, the system.generics again is annoying here, but for now I'm going to add this here so that I can make create of the dictionary of int string and say return value is equal to dictionary of int comma string, oops, string and the constructor, and return value. Okay, good. So what is cribbing here? Let me compile this and see if this really want to crib. Oops, the new keyword is missing, that's why. Okay, now it's good. So there are no errors. That's the first thing I want to get rid of. And runtime errors we can see later. Okay, that's good. So what the next thing? The next thing is I want to say department DAC OBJ. Department DAC is equal to new department DAC. We need to create instance of the department DAC and then OBJ department DAC dot, what is that, create new of our OBJ domain base. So this is what I need to send it, but of course this is going to actually return what? This is going to return me the dictionary of int and string, and for that to capture I have return value, and return value is equal to do this. That's it. That's my BWS layer. Are you serious that we are done? Yes. Technically, yes. To some extent. But still, there are a couple of things in the BWC layer, because if you know, when you do this, what happens in the BWS layer is going to create the respective data line of item into the department table alone, but it's not going to do it in the address also. And remember, this will contain the address also. For that I have to do the address part. With address part I don't have to really worry about, because address is already available. OBJ address is equal to new address DAC, and it's again pretty much simple thing. And what I want to do here is I want to keep these two exceptions, because the address also going to give me a return value. In this case I would say I want to separate. Okay, how I'm going to do is say department errors number one, and another one is the address errors. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to save this with the department, because I want to track if there are errors from the department creation or errors from the address creation. Okay, to do that I'm having this. I'm again trying to make use of the copy paste address. Copy paste is sometimes going to be really killing you, because if you really don't forget what line of code that you want real, okay, I did not, then it might cause a runtime errors. That time you realize that somebody noticed that, okay, because you did the copy paste, you did not, you forgot to change this line of code, and there comes problems. Okay, good, that doesn't matter, nobody cares anyway. Good, so we have the errors from the department and the errors from the address. Now, one another important thing we need to really realize here is how to really make a transaction. As you see, my original model was actually completely a modular, right? None of these create department is actually doing only the insert into the department. Address is inserting only into the address. But where is the transaction? Transactions are now, in my design, going to be handled inside the application itself. So in this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to maintain a transaction for these two. to make sure that although these are two different individual commands that are going in two different ways, I want to maintain a transaction. How can I do that? I can actually do that by using the application specific transactions, which is under system.transactions namespace. You have a very beautiful thing called a transaction scope, and in this case I'm going to make use of this using and say transaction scope tr is equal to new. There is a lot you can do with this transaction. So how powerful the statement is, you can actually maintain a distributed transactions using this scope. What it means by distributed transaction was a database transaction. In this case, I have the database, which is only one database here, application which is sitting in my application native to me. A distributed transaction talks about the transactions across databases. Assume a situation where you want to run a stored proc from a SQL Server database sitting in India, and you want to run another transaction, another stored proc in America sitting somewhere in the centralized data center, and that database is a SQL Server database, and two different databases sitting in two geographic locations. You want to maintain transaction between those two. The same way here, the first call is actually going to India, the second call is coming to US. So both of these two calls, if you want to maintain a transaction, that is your distributed transaction, that you can handle using the transaction scope inside your application. And that's why this is a very, very powerful statement. And you want to explore more on this, there is a lot more to it. The kind of parameters it's going to take, if you see the transactions options, scope options, you can actually have a nested transactions within your code, which can be more complex. I can leave that for you for further research. But for now, we're going to move ahead with the default one, which is going to be not consuming any other transactions that is going to be coming in. In other words, for example, I have this method, and I want to call this create new inside another transaction scope, in which case that method is having another transaction scope again. So there's an outer transaction scope, in which case a nested transaction scope that you can handle it within the nested way. So likewise, you can actually use multiple other options which can be more complicated. For now, we don't want to go there. Okay, we are good with this. And this will maintain within our database across two different stored procs. And for this to work, important thing you need to remember that within the stored procs, you should not issue a commit statement. Commit statement, if you issue in a stored proc, it's going to commit it into your database. And for that to happen, you should not do the commit here. Instead, you will be doing the committing at this part. And how I'm going to do the commit? I'm going to commit this transaction only when there are no errors from these two databases, right? And how can I, because there are two, right? So for that to happen, I only have another return value is equal to my helper. Where is my helper? I did write a small routine that can merge two different collections into one. Okay, I'm going to make use of it, and also will tell you how did I do that and what language concept we use there. It's pretty interesting. Okay, so here return value is equal to, I have something called methods inside my helper dot what convert no I have something called merge, and this merge is actually taking two. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, I have a two dictionary of int and string and two dictionaries of int and in. I'm passing those two, and it's going to merge and give me one dictionary of int and string. So it's going to be helpful to join them and get into one and then check their output. Make sense? Yeah, so in this case I'm going to pass department errors comma address errors, and I will get my return value. In this case, what I'm going to check immediately is return value if it has any errors, that is count is greater than 0. But this can happen only with the if statement, right? If this happens, I would say other way around. If this is equal to 0, then I'm going to say tr.complete. Okay, so this is a method and it is just enclose it. So this statement will ensure that the transaction is committed. Okay, if this using statement doesn't encounter the complete statement, then it's not going to commit your transaction. As simple as that. And you can control that using this. So this will be controlled only when this is equal to 0. Otherwise it will not. Okay, it's easy. It's very easy and very flexible, right? So I have a modular approach to have my data table, stored products, associate them, and tailoring different components into one and maintaining the transaction. So I think you like this approach and you see the benefits out of it, right? Good. So I have done my create new, but is it really done? Not exactly, right? There is one more important thing that BWC layer should do is the validations. We know that there is a validations in the business tier, but in our case, the business tier, business logics are all gone into the DOM. In our case, for employees, we have the respective business rules, and for which we actually made use of the VAB. The VAB-based business rules we used to have it. In for I actually did use different types of validations. Probably for validations it's going to be too late for us today. I will take up the validations probably in the next session. For now we're going to quickly wrap up without validations, and then because validation is going to take some time, and we will definitely cover through that in the next one. But for now, okay, so we will not do any validation calls. We're going to simply call this create new from our next immediate layer, which is the BWC, followed by that you have a UI. So it's now we are jumping all the way back to the UI. Very nice. And of course we forgot one more thing, update. And since I have create new, I can always go back and just want to check if nothing is left out here. Try catch is something I will forgot here, but that's fine. Even if it breaks, I have application level handling which will take care of it. That's fine. Okay, otherwise you want to handle try catch, which is perfectly fine. In this case, what I need to do is the only thing I need to make change here is instead of create, I'll say update. So the pattern of my implementations, everything will be same. Is there anything that is changing? Yes, there is something that is changing here. Yes, one thing we forgot here is the OBJ domain base. We know that this is a HR domain base class, and this is what we just talked about when we are dealing with the data access layer for writing the, when we write the HR data access layer. What I'm doing is I'm passing it directly into this. So in this case, what's happening here is this create new is actually expecting me to pass in an address data access object, whereas I'm actually passing a HR domain base, in which case if this will be when I'm making use with the department, this will be a department but not the address. But of course the department has address within it. So to access that, I have to actually typecast this into department. So department OBJ, department is equal to OBJ domain base, and of course typecast this with department. So now this will give me the department object, in which case I'm going to pass this department into for department. Okay, OBJ. So this is one major mistake. Otherwise, if this is not done, then nothing will work. And for address, I know that the Location is the address which is part of my department, okay, and I'm passing that here. And the same thing I'm going to do for my update as well. Coming down and here pass the OBJ department, and in this case department.location. Good, perfect. I think now we should be good, and we are passing the right values in, and we should be good now. Fine, so we'll jump to the UI. And inside UI, I know that I'm handling within this. I'll go back to my manage department table UI, and in this case it's pretty much blank. And two ways you can do. One way is that you can go ahead and drag the UI controls and drop it onto this and then change it, or else you can go ahead and type your own. So in this case I prefer to go and type my own ASP table. The first thing I'm going to add is table, because we want to realign them properly. Otherwise without table you can, it's hardly difficult to manage them. So I'm going to put them into a table. Again, this is a specific to, in a, if you know HTML well, you can also do HTML here, no issues. You don't, it's not mandatory that you have to use only ASP commands. And I'm passing the run at is equal to server, and ID is equal to say TBL main, some name. Remember one thing with the ASP controls, these are the two attributes that are properties. In other words, you have to specify, otherwise your control will not work. So these are the mandatory things that you need to provide for ASP controls to work. One is the run at server, because they are all server side controls, and for table I'm going to additionally pass the CS class file name, CSS class, to give it a meaningful, some kind of a meaning, have a table content. I'll pick and then close this. And this is my table, and within the table I have a table header row, which again will have the, instead of typing the run at every time, I will prefer to copy both of these and keep it in my buffer and use that every time now. And tblhdr main, some name, and this doesn't have anything, and within this I will have what table cell. You know, if you know HTML as I've been mentioning, it's going to be pretty straightforward again, but this is also fine. I prefer to do this way. There is a difference between using HTML versus doing the ASP.NET table. The only difference is that if I do ASP controls, then I can access them from my code behind. If I want to manipulate at runtime, I will be able to do it. Okay, that's one difference. TBL cell. Right now it doesn't matter, because I will not be using any of these in my code. And label, I'm going to add a label, put some text here, label, say title, and text is equal to say manage department, or simply say department, because manage department is a title already at the page level, so it doesn't make sense to be there. And that's what for the header side. And the next comes the row. Row also has the same thing, TB, I'll say DR. The first row what I'm going to have is the department name. I'll say name. Okay, table row, within the table row I will have a table cell. Instead of doing that, I will go and copy paste this table cell code here and paste it here, so that I have my label recreated. And the label 1, that's fine. Department, I'll say name. And another control I want in the same row is text box. Text box, same thing, I'll say txt name, and this one has nothing, initial text. Another one important thing is the max length. So this is where you can actually enforce the max length constraint. Again, I can put the 50, insert is on, okay, and yes, this is extra. Good, so text box is added up, and we have also added the label and the first row done. Then I would like to have the rest of the things in the next line, so I'm going to copy the whole thing and put it here. And what else we have in the department? HOD, right? HOD, head of department, give me something. So this is going to be TXT HOD, and the HOD we are taking only employee ID, which is a max of 3 digits, and that is fine. Another one is what, location. So location is again interesting. Location is not a single field, it's actually address. Address is going to be a lot of things, line 1, line 2, and lot of stuff we have. So right now this is how we have, and department is the title is not looking that intuitive, because let me make it a little bright, because the header probably I need to apply a CSS style sheet. Probably I have something called title. Yeah, let me see if this can work a little better. Doesn't seem to be very good, but again, for now, let's not waste much time applying all that things. Okay, so the address is a very complex one, because it has a lot of elements. So that's the ideal candidate for me to make it a user control, and which I exactly did. User controls are not much different from any ASPX page. It can be just like this. There's no difference between the user control and the just a page coding wise. Okay, technically there is a big difference. User control cannot sit on air. It has to be part of, it has to sit on a container like a form, in our case a web page, whereas user controls cannot fly on their own. In this case I have a user control called address. And how can I do a user control? I just have to right click, add new item, and you pick something called a user control. Yeah, here you go. This is the user control, the web user control. This is a component that you're going to make use of it. Just have to add this. I'm just showing how to add it. Since already done, I'm good. So you will have the placeholder here. You can either do all the same thing that I just did. You can drag and drop a button there. You can put a checkbox there, or you can write the way I did from the code behind. Everything you can do, and it has the same code behind, and you can, it has the same page lifecycle that we haven't actually covered. We will be covering in the next session, and it's just like the same page, except that it's a user control. Okay, and you will write all the properties and inheritance, everything available as part, just like a page. Once you're done, the only difference is that that becomes as a reusable control that you can use just like your any other normal control. But how to use that? In this case, I'm going to get rid of this. But I did this address a little more beneficial for us to reuse it. What all I did in the user control here, I did actually a lot of code. It has all these properties. I did have the line 1 property, line 2 property, which has the setters and getters, and the setters and getters are actually accessing its input elements inside your control, because the input elements are not going to be accessible from outside. To make them available from other outside from the web page, I actually added these public properties. That's one thing I did. Another thing I did is also added a public property, which is going to create me the address instance from my domain object model, because this will be creating the address instance directly by mapping to all the input elements that it has. And also it's also going to check that if all are null, then it's going to return me a null. So it's doing a couple of customized things, and also it's again a property itself. By itself, the address get address data is a property itself. It has a get. When it's going to get, it's going to recreate the whole instance. So this is a typical best way of where the properties can be used, where the getters can be useful, and also setters can be useful. And when I'm setting it, when I retrieve a value from the database and assign the address as an object to it, it's going to populate the whole control. So it's going to be really useful, isn't it? And enable validation, this is another custom property that I added up. And when I add a property like this, what happens is this property is available from my page wherever I'm going to use it. So I'm going to make use of this. Enable validation is one thing, because if I see permanent address is optional, whereas for example a local mailing address is mandatory, in which case I want to have these validations fire only when I make it a validation true. In this case, I just have to drag this and drop wherever I would like to. I just dropped it here, and the control is created, and the look and feel is okay. And this one address, I like it. I just want to go back and see which style sheet did I really use to get that address here. What is the style sheet? Okay, this is search lit, in other words. Okay, that's what it's used, and I want to use the same thing for my control here as well. Where is my header? Thanks for bearing with me. I'm a little really choosy about all these things, but only certain things we can do. Good, so I have my control added up here, but only thing again, it's losing some of the aesthetics. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a div tag, and it has a class is equal to, it has a class which can be table content, and close the div tag. So I can either put the same thing inside a control, but for now this is fine. Another interesting thing, because this is my custom control, if you want to write it from the manually from the scratch without dragging and dropping, what you need to do is you need to write this line of code, which actually registers the control to this page, and added a tag name called address and the prefix called UC1. And using the UC1, we are actually making use of the controls like UC1 and referring to that. If you pay close attention here, you will now understand what is this ASP really stands about, right? This ASP is actually referring to a set of custom libraries which comes in as part of the base class library. And when I say ASP colon text box, is actually using the exactly same thing. So that's how you can actually do the same thing using your custom controls. So tomorrow if you say what is ASP colon, if somebody asks, then that's actually an alias to the base library. I believe it is system.web.ui.controls is a library. And in this case, I can get all the properties that I have given in my class. So it is very intuitive. In this case, I'm more interested in having the enable validation. In this case, it's optional, right? Because for mailing it, for address, for department, I can make it as an option. So that's fine. I'm going to take this off. It is taken care. Hope this has no issues. And now with this, because I applied the style sheet, it's now in line with both the look and feel, and which is fine. I don't want to really spend more time on that. We will, again, the next step is the code behind. This is our code behind. Of course, before I go to code behind, there should be an action button on my screen to really make use of that control. And again, button is a very simple thing. I don't want to again spend some time. I would like to use the copy paste. And in which case, I would like to go back to my employee table, employee screen, and pick the last part of this where I have the save button. OK, Okay, and in this case I will add this to my page as well at the end of the page. So what this is going to do is I need to of course do a couple of changes here. Number one being, since it's a save, it has an on-click event called BDN save click, which I have to implement. In addition to that, I can also add another button called table cell. Alternate text is going to cancel, and of course this is going to be cancel, and of course the text cancel. So this is the same way, I just apply the other controls wherein you have ID, and for buttons is an alternate text is cancel, and for run at is common again, causes validation is true because this is a postpack button, has a postpack event fire, so when the postpack happens you would like to do validation, that's why it's true. And this will call causes validation will not be available for label or text boxes because they don't do a postback. Again, if you don't know what's a postback, then while I'm walking through, I will try to give you the intros to that if you don't know, but try to grasp it because I will not be doing a complete ASP.NET training because this is, as you know, this is just an overview of ASP.NET and we are just scratching the surface. Trust me, this is just a surface we are scratching. There are a ton of things you can do with ASP. But one limitation I see here with Visual Studio IDE, probably there's a lot of improvements need to be done. What is missing here is if I keep these controls within the table, I actually cannot make use of the IDE capabilities to create a code for it. If you see, it's the whole thing is taken as a one control, which is a table, and I don't see any events. The events that I see here, if I want to add a click event there, it doesn't really help me. So the other workaround that I choose to have is to take these controls out of the table for now till I make use of and save this and go here, and if you see now the controls are available, now I can go and access any of the events of the of that respective click. Since I already assigned a click event there, it's there, I just have to double click here and I have the body in my code. And similarly I will go for cancel and double click here and I have the body. I just care to have the body and the rest all is going to be done by myself, right? So now it's again good to take it back, and probably I can put some cell padding and cell spacing and other things to increase the distance between those two controls. For now I really don't care. Okay, we will come back to the aesthetics. That's a tough job or time-taking job. We are here with the save. Now what is the immediate thing that we need to do in the save click event? Remember the actor here? The actor here is going to click the click event, and immediately the UI is going to create an instance of the employee and then make the create new of my BWC, right? So that's what I'm going to do here. First thing I should do is create the department because I'm handling the department. And in this case, okay, I can have my department at my root level. Because department, if I want to have it, of course I have to include the namespace. Do I have it now? No, I don't have it. Using my HR project DOM, and what else I need? I need the business workflow, BWL, and those are the two things that I need. And of course, before I have these two available as a using, I have to also make sure that I add the respective assemblies referred, in which case we have already done because I already referred to the BWL and the DOM and also the helper. I already have those references here. Okay, yeah, that's how I am able to add those references here. And in this case, department, I'll say department, since this is a class level variable, I'm actually having this way. again, as a best practice with respect to the GC, the way it's going to promote these objects to the higher generation, it's not recommended to have a global level, class level. Just for a demo sake, just to have a class level member and how can I make use of it, I'm just using it here. Otherwise, it can be pretty much at the within the scope of my command click, which is the best way to do it. Okay, but for now, it should be fine. And in this case, what I'm going to do is I want to create an instance of this and populate the department with the values that are filled up from the UI. For that, to facilitate my reusability, I'm going to do as a private member, private method, which can actually return a department, and I'll say create department object. Okay, and what it's going to do is nothing but making use of my department that I have created in the otherwise, you know, let's go back. I don't want to really bring in a lot of trouble because we'll just adhere to the best practices. Make it as a local member. What I'm going to do is okay, this is going to create a new one. In this case, it will have a local member of its own, and which is going to die soon because it's local scope. That means we know that the concept of most of the objects dying young, and the zero generation objects can be cleaned up quickly. So that's why it's always good to have within this method scope, which is fine. And in this case, I'm going to return, of course, the same thing, department. Perfect. Now I need to fill this department before I send this out. Department dot, I have the ID is the one thing that we will not be filling up. The name we're going to fill up with our txt name dot text, sorry, text, and oh good, so name is a string and the text is a string, no problem. This will be a problem when I go with the location is an address one, which we will do in the subsequent step, but head is the other one. Head is equal to this dot txt hod dot text. So this is how I'm actually taking my UI inputs back to my head. And again, remember, this is again a problem because the text is going to give you a string and int is going to give you, it's actually int. And remember our fundamental things that we want to make this as a nullable type so that we don't really want to worry about it. In this case, this is not a nullable type and I want to make this a nullable type by just adding a question mark. By design, it is not. Since the property is nullable type, of course, its underlying private member should also be nullable type. So I'm going to decorate that also with the question mark, in which case this becomes a nullable type. And now the error we will resolve. So what happens here is when user don't enter anything, that I want to transform this into a null instead of, you know, in as an empty string, because empty string also means something, but null means null. Okay, for that I have a helper classes as I mentioned. Probably I have that reference or not. I think I have the helper reference at the top. No, so I'm going to add that using my dot helper. Assembly is referred, but the namespace is not. And in this case, I'll say within the helpers class, I have a methods. This is again a static class, and within this, I have is null. In this case, I need to pick the int. But by the way, what I did in this implementation, we'll just walk through that. It's interesting. It does the same if and else logic. Go to definition. And what it's trying to do is it's going to use a try pass. This is one of the basic fundamental thing which we discussed earlier. And that's what I'm actually doing here. Using the int.try pass, because I'm taking a string and want to return a nullable int. And checking if this is possible. If it is not possible, then of course, when you pass it, if this try pass is the goodness of try pass is that if the value fails conversion, then it's going to transform that into a null in the return value. Otherwise, it's going to give the value. So that's the only thing. So once I do that, I'm returning that value out, so that this will be null automatically with, by the try-pass mechanism, how it works. And I use the same try-pass for to implement the respective places, but the respective try-pass I picked. In this case, if I have to return the ulong, then I use the uin64 try-pass, and the other case I picked the in32. In one of the other cases, here is a string again. String is again a special case because it's a reference type, and in which case I made use of the is null or white space, which will take, even if you put a space there, it's going to be transformed into a null because I'm going to return it to null. Okay, and what else I have? Dictionary. And this is another thing, is converting. Okay, we are a little far from the validations and other things. We'll come back. Merge is one thing we used, and the implementation is, again, since we have both the operands or the input parameters here are of type dictionary. How did I merge? I did not use a for or for each or iteration loop. I actually made use of the two dictionary conversion here, and I used a lambda expression here. And I hope you remember the lambda expressions. This is how we can make use of the lambda expressions, in which case I transform the x. Here in this case, since the errors that I'm going to get, the numbers I are not predefined, that's why I'm just auto-generating some random number. R&D stands for random. The random is a class that you can make use of it to create a random number, and you can specify the limit, three-digit number, and I'm just doing that. So the numbers in the errors that you see on the top side, you see three-digit number, and that's going to be a random number. Okay. In real business case, you will have a fixed numbers for each of the error messages, which will be part of a resource table or a resource file. In our case, we keep it simple, and the value that's coming in from the concatenation. So we're actually concatenating and transforming that into two dictionary. Concatenate itself will going to join two things. The source is the source dictionary, and it's actually concatenating the destination. That means joining, and then transforming the whole thing into two dictionary. And this is the shortest way we are make use of it to transform or merge two different generic lists or collections into one collection. So it's an interesting code. You may want to walk through it later time. Good. And in this case, I transform this text to int. In case if it has a valid number, it's going to get me the value, otherwise null. Good. That's taken care of. Department dot now location. Location is a easy peasy because I already have my control. And in this case, what is the control name I gave? Did I give any control name? I think it's address one. Okay, address one dot address data. So that's all I need from address, because the way I implemented the user control is makes my life easy, because it's going to create the address object and give it to me. And that object is actually doing all that painful stuff to call the respective isNull string and populate my address and also check if it is a null or not, and then return a null. The whole thing it is doing, and now it is easy for me to consume it. And also, is this a nullable? Let me check. No, it's not a nullable. I want to make, anyway, it doesn't matter because it's itself is a reference type. Remember, address is a reference type because it's actually a class. Okay, I don't have to make it as a nullable type. Nullable type is applicable only for value types, because for reference types you can assign a null anyway. Good. So this is what they're going to create me the department object. And once I create the department here, I won't actually, in this case, I don't want to instantiate with new, because the department is actually created using my call. In this case, I would say this dot create department object. Oops, is it, oh yeah, I did not put T here, my bad. And once I have this department created, all I need to do is call the department BWC OBJ. I forgot to put the OBJ here. I will put it now. And DCAP, okay, department BWC is equal to new department BWC. Okay, and that's taken care. And now the last step, OBJ department BWC dot create new, and I pass OBJ department object to it. And that's all I need to do. And what will happen to the errors that are going to come back, which is yes, that we did not handle that. What I need to do is capture it in a dictionary of int comma string and say errors errors is equal to this. And what I'm going to do with this errors, I need to show it on the screen, right? How will I show? I have a special thing here to tell you. This is one of the tips that I would like to give you. By default, your ASPX pages are actually inherited from system.web.ui.page, right? And if I want to really customize the way I want to do for each and every page, I can write another page that can inherit, that your normal pages can inherit, and implement a generic functionality that can be applicable for all the pages in your application. How can I do that? I actually exactly did the same thing here. In this case, I have something called my app code. If I'm brought app code dot general base, I actually have two base classes. One is a mother base, which is a base of everything. This is the same inheritance concepts we are dealing with. And surprisingly or interestingly, we are actually dealing with the page, a code base page to a code base page that's associated to a ASPX page. So it's a wide way we are using. This is just a code page which is under app code, which is a general base page. And again, I'm just inheriting my manage department, which is my ASPX page. Okay, so this is the page which is actually making use of. Code behind is this CS, and it's actually inheriting from your manage department. So this page is actually making use of this code behind class. Okay, and again, another important thing with ASPX, ASP.NET, is the separation of the UI and the code. If you take a look at the code that we have, if you compare this code with ASP, legacy ASP code, it's quite different, right? Now in this case, I'm actually doing only the UI elements. I'm not adding any code associated to those UI elements. So that's the neatness of separation of both the layers. And now only the, all the code that handles these UI elements, excuse me, is in the code behind, which is completely a C# code. So that's the biggest advantage versus having it from using ASP versus the .NET platform. Okay, so this is one of the major tasks for which the ASP.NET was started, the research-wise. That's the overview we saw. And now this is taken care. And now what we're going to do is errors. The errors, we want to show it. The reason why I took you there, the base class here, if I go drill down into my base class implementation, what I have written here is about the validation summary. This validation summary, surprisingly, is another control that I have used, and this time this is a custom control. Okay, again, what is a custom control and what is a user control? We are going to see that. So user control, we have seen ASCX is a user control, whereas a custom control is a completely code-based control. You can create the same control without having any look and feel, but actually you can have a look and feel as well. You can have a UI to the control, but it's going to be completely a code-based control. In this case, what I have is a validation summary control, because this is a summary control that you're normally seeing on the UI. Ideally, this summary control is also available to you as a drag and drop control under the validation tab. If you go to see this validation tab, you have this validation control, a validation summary control, which you can actually drag and drop into the page, and you can do the validations. But that same validation control, I'm actually customizing it the way I want to show my custom errors. So normally, ideally, the way the custom the validation control work is, if I use any of the validation controls, which we are going to see in the next validations, how to handle the validations in the next session. But for now, what we're going to see here is the validation summary control. This summary control can handle only the exceptions that have been raised by any of these controls. So it's not going to take it that way. But it's a very good control wherein I can actually show all my summary of validations, but that I want to leverage to handle the way I have my exceptions coming from my business layer. In that case, for leveraging that, I actually made that summary control to a custom control and added that custom control as part of my base control, base page. This is my base page, and this doesn't have a UI. Keep in mind, that doesn't have a UI. What it is doing is it's actually further inheriting to something called a base page, which is my application specific base page, and this is what inheriting the UI.page. So if you see the inheritance hierarchy, the base one is web.ui.page, and next comes the, in other words, if I freeze this span here and do this, check this here, the UI.page is the base one, and next immediately is the base page, and then I have general base page, and then our page, our whatever your business specific page, and in our case it's a department. Okay, so this is how the inheritance hierarchy now looks like for my design. So what this is giving you a hold here is I can do anything that I want to apply to all the pages in my application, but in that case I have to inherit from this base page directly. Instead, I have another middle layer within this called my module specific base page, in this case a general. We know that we already have a couple of modules like a general and admin. In this case, I have this general base page where this is specific to handle anything that's specific to the general module. And then comes our module specific pages wherein they will inherit from the module specific base page. And another dimension to this would be having admin base page, which I believe I already have, or no, I don't have, probably admin base page, which will be inheriting from base page. So that's how the hierarchy is going to look like, in which case this all the admin specific module specific pages will inherit from base admin base page. So what this is going to give you is another additional handle for you to do things like this. In this case, I'm actually doing a validation summary control, and I'm actually initializing that control by reading the main validation summary from the from a main form. I'm actually reading the control that I'm having from my form and initializing my validation summary control. And this is again a custom validation summary control. And that's control, if you have noticed, it's there as part of my code, which is called a custom control, not a user control. User control do normally have a UI, which forms with the extension called ASCX, whereas the custom controls don't have any extension. They are code files. Code files, and they are part of like your library, like just like this. This is a custom control library. You just have to add a reference to this library and make use of it. In this case, there is no designer for this. Everything is a code. This is a custom control that I have. but I'm going to make use of the same attributes driven approach, wherein I can create the properties that can be exposed, and this even specifies once I drag and drop this control on the UI, what is the default thing that it needs to draw, which is in this case, it's going to draw the custom validation summary and then run net statement and then custom validation summary. So that's how it's going to be creating. Okay, so this control, to make it happen, excuse me, what we need to do is we need to inherit from the respective control. In this case, I am actually inheriting from the web controls validation summary control, which is we have seen in the UI, and it's already also implementing the iNaming container, which makes this control to be part, you can make use of drag and drop way, you can drop it into the UI also, which I did exactly for my master. In this case, again, the general master is one of the module specific master page where I can have all my look and feel, and in this case, so this is the control that's available as part of my custom control. This will be available inside the tooltip either soon after you add a reference to that particular library into your application, which is coming as part of the references. And where is my, yeah, here you go, this is my custom control. Or if it doesn't appear by default, then you can also right click on this and choose items, go through the tool to locate your DLL, and then load it into the toolbox. And it will load up into the toolbox once you have the iName container implementation and provide its implementation of how you want to draw the way I showed you. It's taking a little more than what I expected, because it's actually trying to load all the objects in your that are registered in the GAC and also in your local assemblies, and then going to bring that list out. And it's, all these controls are from the GAC. In addition, you can also browse and locate the DLL in this case. In this case, our custom library, and then add it to it, and it will be appearing inside your toolbox. Once it is available here, you can actually drag and drop into any way you want. I'm going to roll this back, but that's how it's going to create, it's going to register the custom controls just the way just like ACX worked and give you the hole there. Okay, so this is my custom validation summary control, and what it is doing here in this control primarily is going to have a couple of public methods, which is add messages. That means the error messages that are whatever I'm getting from the business layer, I'm adding them to this control, so that it's going to add to the validation summary and show it up in the screen. Okay, this control is implemented, and you're free to download this and walk through the implementation. It's going to be more interesting and very useful. Fine, so taking that, my base page is actually giving me handle to my validation summary code, and now I go back to my page here. So what all that hurdle saved me here? So if I have these errors, I just want to show it on the screen. Also, all that infrastructure code that I have written is going to be simply accessible with my this dot validation messages dot add messages, and I'll say errors. So this one line of code will take all my pain out. So this is the reason how you can make use of all other things work for you. And okay, so that line of code, my business specific page is going to make it very simple for me. And of course, in this case, save is the only one button, but I have two action items called update as well, in which case update is a separate thing we will deal with the next session. We're going to see the save part. If errors dot count is equal to zero, then I'll say with this messages, you can actually add a single message. In this case, other case, I was actually adding a collection of messages. In the first case, I just have only one message, right? So that's why I have another flavor of this, which is add message. And in this case, what it's going to take, it's going to just take a string, right? That's how I implemented the validation summary control. Saved successfully. Good. Done. Login. It's directly jumping into my department page because I'm actually working on that, and the setting I have it from my web settings is to start with the page that I work with, and I'll pick the GOVT and 106, and I'll put some address also, GOVT street and say some city, GOVT say Jersey for now, and NJ and some value. Good. Since I made this validation is equal to turn false, I don't see those red stars that I see normally in employee page, if you remember. Now I'm not seeing that because of that setting. Good. So now I'm going to walk through this, and before I do create object, did it create the department? Yes, it did create 106 and GOVT, and the location. Did it have the values? Yes, it does have the values. So no issue with the OBJ department. And now we'll use our debugging tools to debug. And this is where I want to step in to get into the create new. And in this case, do we have the department that we have passed in? Yes, we do have the department that we have passed in. Till this point, it's good. And F10 again, DSC, address DSC, and transaction scope. We are again drilling down into the respective department database and create the database here, execute that. It didn't have any problem there. And we'll come into the next one. Yes, so what happened here is the ID. Yes, now I understood what's wrong with this. What I'm going to do here is remember the transaction. So the order in which I orchestrated the transaction is wrong. Okay, so that's the fundamental thing that I missed it. If you take a look at the way our design is laid out, the department table have a address, which is location, refers the referential integrity to the address table. So which means that prior I use the address, I actually need to save the address first. I have to save the address first and then get the address ID back to the department table. And then that's how the transaction should be orchestrated. So the first record I need to put in is the address, but I actually did not do that. What I did is other way around. So I have to go back to my PWC layer. In this case, PWC layer. Yep, we are in the PWC. So I have to, orchestration wise, I have to flip-flop this. So department is done. First, I need to actually change my orchestration back to save the address first, and of course doing that you need to actually read the address ID back and assign it to the department. How did I do that? Actually, I implemented the address in such a way that it also returns me the ID, in which case I need to actually have an out parameter, in which case it's going to be int output and use that to pass it inside my address. Create new has a two flavors here, and one of the second flavor is takes the output. Okay, so to save our time, all these hurdles I have taken care so that we can of course, this is an out parameter, I need to specify out keyword there. So I get the address created at this point and the ID is returned here. How did that happen? That goes all the way back to the create address. Where is this create address? Here, the create address, once I insert that, I'm actually returning the address ID, calling the identity current. That means this is an, because the address ID is an identity column that I have, and I'm actually returning that identity. That means the current value of that ID. And since it has an out parameter, if you take a look at this, StoreProc has an out parameter here, which is what they, I'm going to get it out. And my implementation wise, in the DAL for address, it has two flavors. Number one is the create new without the out parameter, and the other one is the without parameters. Okay, and the with the out parameter one, what it does is it has the same out. It does all the same fundamental things, except that it adds another parameter called add out parameter, and that's your address ID. Once it is done, execute non-query, we're actually reading that out using the get parameter value and passing the respective parameter name, which is the address ID. This gives me the ID from the database that we are getting, and that's what being written out using the out parameter. Okay, clear? And now we will go jump back to this, and we're going to make use of that out to assign it to my OBJ department. OBJ department dot location dot ID is equal to output. So now I have the location ID created, and that's what I need to actually save it into my department table. Okay, so let me try this out. Okay, and the BWL and data access layer, oops, where is that, manage employee, no, manage department. Okay, so we say govt and say 105 and govt street, and city is say city or Jersey is what I was. What I'm trying to give some valid information so that we can make use of this same data for our reporting. If I put some junk data, then probably I will not have a good data to test reports. Okay, this is good. And I'm going to quickly jump into the BWC layer here and see if I have the out. I have 45, which is good. And I'm going to run this straight away and see if I still have any errors. No. This is saved successful, which is good. We can leave early now. And how will I know that this is successfully saved? We have our grid view, a quick, easy one for now. And see if the department is added up. Yes, we see that there is a department row created, 18 govt. Earlier also it did create, probably. I don't know what went wrong, but we have an exception some stage, looks like something went wrong, but looks like the same value got added twice, in which case the first case doesn't have the location, but the second case does have the location. So if there's some flaw, we probably need to investigate later, but for now we're able to successfully save it to the database, and we will continue again in the next session. For now we'll end up this session. So in this session 32, we did walk through the application demo once again, mapping to the multi-layer design that we have in the first place. And we did walk through the step-by-step implementation of a save scenario following the multi-layer design, starting from the database to the data access layer implementation, business workflow layer implementation, and binding all these elements to the UI. And we similarly, we did see the enterprise library 5.0 overview, and also how can we leverage data access application blocks into our program to do the CRUD operations. And exception handling application blocks, we did walk through the enterprise library 5.0, how can we configure and how can we use it along with the logging application blocks. And also we did see ASP.NET user control, how can we create and consume it, and also an overview, a code walkthrough for the custom control as well, and the differences between the user control and the custom control. And also helper module, we did see the static class, how we can make use of it in a helper class, and we'll continue with the next level of development in the next